summer's ardent arms outspread, entwined with flowers. Embrace us, like two lovers newly wed, through ravished hours. Then sorrow, woe, and pain lose all their powers, for each is dead, and life is only ours. Exploding under the bed is the only thing likely to lift you out of it.
He was fast in the arms of Marcus. He was one of the infernal deities. Son of Saldus, wasn't he?
We think so.
Oh, that poppy was his emblem, wasn't it?
Oh, I don't know.
Can you call this morning?
That's quite plain. I'm not going to get much peace and quiet in this house. The Angelus rang some time ago.
The Angelus? It couldn't be that late, could it? I asked the commie at 9 so I could get mass before I went to me around. Why didn't you give us a rap?
Give you a rap? Why, man, they've been thundering at the door and hammering at the windows for the past 2 hours till the house shook to its very foundations. But you took less notice of the infernal din than I would to the strumming of a grasshopper.
There's no fear you feel thinking of anyone else with your poetry. The land of saints and scholars are sure to be a land of bloody poets. I suppose Maguire's come and gone, huh?
Maguire? No, he hasn't been. Why were you expecting him?
He said he'd be here at 9. Before the last chime of strokes is he, I'll be coming in on the door. And it must be... What time is it now?
It must be 12:30.
Did anybody ever see the like of the Irish people? Have everything packed and ready? Have everything packed and ready?
And have you everything packed and ready?
See us and have an anthem packed and ready when he didn't come. Suppose he was too damn lazy to get up. He wanted the streets to be well aired forced. Oh, Kathleen, me hooligan, your way's a thorny way.
Oh, me, alas, pain, pain, forever and ever.
That's from Shelley's Prometheus Unbound. I could never agree with Shelley. Not that there's anything to be said against him as a poet. As a poet, but you know what I mean.
So, he's sure flung a few stones through stained glass windows.
He wasn't the first. He won't be the last to do that. The stained glass windows, more than ever, I'm here still. And Shelley's doing a jazz dance down below.
And you actually rejoice and are exceedingly glad that, as you believe, Shelley, the sensitive, high-minded, noble-hearted Shelley, is suffering the torments of the damned.
I rejoice in the vindication of church and truth.
You know as little about truth as anybody else, and you care as little about the church as the least of those that profess our faith. Your religion is simply a state of being afraid of God torturing your soul in the next world, as you're afraid of the blackened hands torturing your body in this one.
Yeah, go on, me boy. I'll have a right laugh at you when both of us are dead.
And you're welcome to laugh at me as much as you like when both of us are dead.
I don't think I need to wash myself this morning. Do I look all right?
You're all right. It's too late to start washing yourself. Didn't you wash yourself yesterday?
I gave myself a great robe yesterday. I think I'll bring out a few of the braces too, dammit. They're well worth sixpence each. Did you see them?
Yes, you showed them to me before.
There's great stuff in them. I only hope I can get enough of them. I'm wearing a pair of myself. They do cuculean, they're so strong. There's a dozen in each of these passes. 3, 6, 9. Dammit, there's only 11 in this one. Let's try another. 3, 6, 9. Damn it, there's only 11 in this one, too. One in a bent. I suppose I'll have to go through the whole bloody lot of them. I never be easy in my mind thinking there might be more than a dozen in some of them. And still we're looking for freedom. Ye gods, it's a glorious country. Ah, Jesus. There's the braces at.
That doesn't look like they were strong enough for Cú Chulainn.
I put a heavy strain on them too sudden. There's that fella Maguire. Never toned up either. He's nearly too lazy to wash himself. This is a nice 9 o'clock. What's the use of you coming at this hour of day, huh? You think we're going to work the moonlight? If you weren't going to come at nine, couldn't you say you weren't going to come at nine?
All right, keep your hair on. I just blew in to tell you I couldn't go today at all. I have to go to Knock Sedan instead.
Knock Sedan? What in the name of God's bringing you to Knock Sedan?
Business. I'm going out to catch some butterflies.
If you want to make a card of anybody, make a card of somebody else. Here, I've had everything packed and ready for hours. You were to be here at nine, and you wait till just 1 o'clock to come rushing in like a mad bull to say you've got to go to Knock Sedan. Can't you leave Knock Sedan tomorrow?
Can't be did, Seamus. For if I wait until tomorrow, all the butterflies might be dead. I'll leave this bag here till tonight. Goodbye!
This is a hopeless country. There's a fellow who thinks that the four cardinal virtues are not to be found outside Nice Republic. I don't want to boast about myself. And I suppose I could call myself as good a Gael as some of them that are knocking about now. As good a Gael as some of them that are knocking about now. But I remember the time when I taught Irish 6 nights a week, when in the Irish Republican Brotherhood I paid me right and heavy like a man. And when the church refused to have anything to do with James Stevens, I had a prayer for the repose of his soul on the steps of the Pro Cathedral. Now, after all my work for the Dark Rosaline, the only answer you get from a roaring Republican to a simple question is, oh boy, in the name of God's bringing him to Knock Sedan.
Hadn't you better go on out and ask him?
Oh, that's right, make a joke about it. That's the Irish people all over. They treat a joke as a serious thing, and a serious thing as a joke. Well, I hope he'll have a happy day in Knock Sedan. Who's that?
Halt and give the countersign, man. Damn it, can't you go and see?
Good day, Mr. Shields. Tis myself that hoped you're feeling well. Well, you're looking well anyway. We can't go be looks nowadays.
What's the matter? Well, I'm looking well, I'm feeling well. I'm all right, thanks be to God.
I'm very glad to hear it.
What's the matter whether you're glad to hear it or not, Mr. Mulligan?
You're not inclined to be very civil, Mr. Shields.
Okay, Mr. Mulligan, if you've come to raise an argument, I've things to do, let me tell you that.
I didn't come here to raise no argument. A person with small gains argue fine with you. Let me tell you that.
I've no time to be standing here gossiping with you. Let me shut the door, Mr. Mulligan.
You shut no door to hear what I got to say.
Say it then, and go about your business.
You're very high and mighty. What do you care? You're not going to get a drop.
Are you going to let me shut the door, Mr. Mulligan?
What a beam you are not to know what brings me here. Maybe Tullo's going to ask you to come to tea.
Me, lass. Pain, forever and ever.
I've come from your rent. You don't like that you've been asked to pay your just and lawful debts?
You'll get your rent when you learn to keep your rent book in a proper way.
I'm not to get any lessons from you anyhow.
I want to have no more talk with you, Mr. Mulligan.
Talk or no talk, you owe me 11 weeks' rent. And it's written down in guinea in black and white.
I don't care a damn if it's written down in green, white and yellow.
You're a terribly independent fella. Hey, it'll be more in your line to be less funny and to stop trying to be billiging decent and respectable people.
Just you be careful, Mr. Mulligan. There's law in the land still.
Oh, be me foul, there is. And you're going to get a little of it now. Ding's for you.
I won't have nothing to do with you, Mr. Mulligan.
Oh, what am I glad. It was a sad day I ever let you come into this house. But maybe they notice it's a quit. We'll stop you writing letters and papers about me in the house.
Could you two ever stop discussing the matter like a pair of primitive troglodytes?
Writing letters and papers is my business, and I write as often as I like, when I like and how I like.
You will not write with this house by all accords. Oh, you can blow with the state of the yard, but you care to say nothing about paying rent. No, that's not in your line. But if you don't like this house, you can pack up and go to another.
Go when I think fit, and no sooner.
Not content with keeping the rent, we'll start to bring in lodgers. Not that I've anything against you now, sir, but bringing in lodgers will unbutch you to buy your leave. What's the world coming to at all when a man's house isn't his own? Well, I soon put a stop to you, Gallop. For the 28th of next month, out you go. I'd be few sorry to see your back.
I'll go when I like.
I'll let you see whether you own the house or no.
I'll go when I think fit no sooner.
We'll see about that.
We'll see.
Aye, we'll see.
We'll see.
Mind you, I'm in earnest. You're not stopping this house 1 minute longer than the 28th.
I'll go to hell!
What in the name of all God that persuaded me to come to a house such as this?
It's nothing when you're used to it. You're too thin-skinned altogether. The outside's got the wind up about you, that's all.
Got the wind up about me?
He thinks you're on the run. He's scared of a raise and that his lovely property will be destroyed.
Why in the name of all that sensible should he think that I'm on the run?
They all think you're on the run. Mrs. Grigson thinks it. Mr. and Mrs. Henderson thinks it. Tommy Owen thinks it. Minnie Powell thinks it too. I better be out of here if I want to do anything today.
What are we going to do about these notices to quit?
I shoved them up there in the mantelpiece behind one of the statues.
I mean, what action are we going to take?
I haven't time to talk about it now. We'll talk about it when I come back. And mind you, I'll get my own back at that old mulligan yet. I wish to God they'd come and smash his rookery to pieces, for that's all he thinks of. And mind you, old mulligan would call himself a descendant of the true Gaels of Bamba. The prouder the chieftains are famed in his fail is true Aganidder Navarra, the stars of our sky and the salt of our soil. O Cackley Nihulahin, your way's a thorny way.
Don Logo Davarin, your way's a thorny way. Your last state is worse than your first. I'm here, alas, pain, forever and ever. Like thee, Prometheus, no change, no pause, no hope. Life. Ach, another fury come to plague me. You can knock till you're tired.
Are you in, Mr. Shield?
No, Minnie, he's just gone out. If you run out quickly, you'll be sure to catch him.
Oh, it's all right, Mr. Devlin. You'll do just as well. I just come in for a drop of milk for a cup of tea. I shouldn't be troubling you this way, but I'm sure you don't mind.
No trouble in the world. Delighted, I'm sure. There, will that be enough for you?
Plenty. Lashes, thanks. Alone all the day, Mr. Devlin?
No, indeed, I wish to God that I was.
Is that good for you, Dan? I don't know how you like to be by yourself, but I couldn't stick along.
No.
No, indeed. There's nothing I'm more fond of than a hooly. I was at one last Sunday. I danced rings around. Tommy Owens was there. You know Tommy Owens, don't you?
We can't say that I do.
Dana, the little fella that lives with his mother in the two pairback. Oh, the gorgeous melody play.
A gift of son of Orpheus, eh?
You said it, Mr. Devlin. The son of poor old Matty Owens, he was a weeshy, darny bit of a man. He was never sober and was always taught politics. Poor man had killed him in the long run.
A man should always be drunk, Minnie, when he talks politics. It's the only way to make them important.
Tommy takes after the old fella too. He talks from morning till night when he has a few jars in him. Poetry's a grand thing, Mr. Devlin. I'd love to be able to write a poem. A lovely poem on Ireland in the minute 98.
We've had enough poems, Minnie, about Ireland in about 98 too.
Oh, there's a thing for Republicans to say. But I know what you mean. It's time to give up the writing and take to the gun. What's Mr. Shields doing with the old wigs?
Those aren't shields. They're money. Wildflowers is a kindlier word for them, Minnie, than weeds. These are wild violets. And this is an arum maculatum, or wake robin. And these are celandines. A very beautiful flower, related to the buttercup. One day, when morn's half-opened eyes were bright with sweet sunshine, my hand was clasped in yours, dear love, and yours were clasped in mine. We bowed as worshippers before the golden celandine.
Aren't they lovely? And isn't the poem lovely too? I wonder now who she was.
She? She who?
But, oh, but the way you don't know.
No, I'm sure I don't know.
It doesn't matter anyhow. That's her own business. I suppose I don't know her.
Know her? Know whom?
Her whose hand was clasped in yours and yours was clasped in hers.
That was simply a poem I quoted about the Celandines. That might refer to any girl. To you, for instance.
But you have a sweetheart all the same, Mr. Davern, haven't you?
Aye. No. Not one, Minnie.
Oh, no. You can tell that to someone else. Aren't you a poet, and aren't all the girls fond of poets?
That may well be, but all the poets aren't fond of girls.
They are in storybooks, aye. And fond of more than one, too. Are you fond of them, Mr. Davern?
Of course I like girls, Minnie. Especially girls who can add to their charms by the way they dress. Like you, for instance.
Oh, no. You're on for codding me, Mr. Davern.
No, Minnie. Really, I'm not. You're a very charming little girl indeed.
Then if I'm a charming little girl, you ought to be able to write a poem about me.
And so I will, so I will. We've written them about girls not half as pretty as yourself.
I knew you had one. I knew you had one now.
Nonsense. Not every girl a poet writes about is his sweetheart. Annie Laurie wasn't a sweetheart of Bobby Burns.
You needn't tell me she wasn't. And for bonnie Annie Laurie, I'd lay me down and die. No man you'd lay down and die for any but a sweetheart. Not even for a wife.
No man, Minnie, willingly dies for anything.
Except for his country, like Robert Emmet.
Even he would have lived if he could. He died not to deliver Ireland. The British government killed him to save the British nation.
You're joking now. You die for your country.
We don't know so much about that.
And you won't. You won't. You won't. I know what you are.
And what am I?
A gunman on the run.
Maybe I am. And maybe I'm not.
I know. I know. I know. Do you never be afraid?
Afraid? Afraid of what?
Why, the ambushes, of course. I'm all a tremble when I hear a shot going off, and what must it be in the middle of the firing?
I'll admit, one does get a bit nervous at first. But a fella gets used to it after a while. Till at last, a gunman throws a ball! As carelessly as a schoolboy throws a snowball.
I wish it was all over all the same. You'll take care of yourself, won't you? Won't you, Donald? I mean, Mr. Davern.
Call me Donald, Minnie. We're friends. Great friends now. Come on, Minnie. Call me Donald. Let me hear you say Donald.
This place badly needs a tidying up. Donald. There now. Are you satisfied? But it really does. It's in an awful state. Tomorrow's a half day. I'll come in and I'll straighten it up a bit.
No, Minnie. You're far too pretty for that sort of work. And besides, the people at the house will be sure to start talking about you.
And do you think Minnie Powell cares whether they'll talk or no? She's had to push her way through life all the way up to this without any help from anyone. And she's not going to ask their leave now to do what she wants to do.
My soul within art thou, Minnie. A pioneer in action, as I am a pioneer in thought. These two powers that are grasped this sorry scheme of things entire and mould life nearer to the heart's desire. Lovely little Minnie. Brave as well. Brave little Minnie. And lovely as well.
Oh, I say none. Honest, I thought he was nailing it to type right. Next time, have him, please. Yeah. I say nothing else now, so help me, God.
We'll be hard put if we mind what you'd say in Tommy Young.
Right, Minnie. Tommy Young's has a heart. Even Mr. Davern. Don't mind me coming in. I'm Tommy Young's. I live up in the two pair back. I'm walking in Ross and Walpole's. Mr. Shales knows me well. You needn't be afraid of me now, Mr. Davern.
Why should I be afraid of you, Mr. Owens? Or of anybody else?
Why should you indeed? Sure, we're all friends here. Mr. Shales knows me well. All you've got to say is, do you know Tommy Owens? And he'll tell you the sort of man that Tommy Owens is. There's no flies on Tommy Owens, you got me?
For goodness sake, Tommy, will you leave Mr. Davern alone? He's got enough burden to tell him already.
No, not a word, Minnie. Not a word. Mr. Davern understands me well, as man to man. It's up the Republic all the time, eh, Mr. Davern?
I know nothing about the Republic, and I have no connection with the politics of the day, nor do I want to have any connection.
Oh,
Aye, and needn't say no more. I'm not as good as a wink to a blind horse. You have no making or meddling in it. Good, bad, or indifferent. Pro or con. I know it.
And many here knows it. Oh, here, give me your hand there, Mr. Dabber. Now, two firm hands clasped together will all the power outbrave the heartless English tyrant, the Saxon coward and knave. That's Tommy Owen's hand, Mr. Davern, the hand of a man. A man. Mr. Shields knows me well.
High up on the gallows tree stood the noble-hearted tree by the vengeful tyrant stricken in their bloom.
But they met him face to face with the spirit of their race, and they went with souls undaunted to their doom.
Tommy Owens, for goodness'
sake! God save Ireland, says the heralds. God save Ireland, says we all. Whether on the scaffold high or on the battlefield we die.
Oh, what matter where, for Ireland there we fall. Oh, Mr. Davern, I would die for Ireland.
I know you would. I know you would, Tommy.
But I never got a chance. They never gave me a chance.
But I'll say, I would be dead if I was called upon. Mr. Shields knows that. As Mr. Shields, Mr.
There's
Davern.
No necessity. I know you're the right sort of stuff if you get the call. Yeah. But remember, he also stands, serves he who stands and waits.
But I'm bleeding, well, tired of waiting. We're all tired of waiting.
Why isn't every man in Ireland out fighting with the IRA? Up with the barricades.
Up with the barricades! It's now or never. Now or forever. As Sir Phil said on the Battle of Ellinger Hill. Up with the barricades! And that's Tommy Owens, Mr. Davern. As a penny boys a whistle. And let any man who thinks different say different. What do you say, Mr. Davern?
I say, Tommy, you ought to run up and get your dinner, because if you wait much longer, it won't be worth the eating.
Who can think of his dinner when Ireland is out fighting to be free?
Not Tommy Owens, anyhow. It's only the Englishman that does be thinking of his belly.
Tommy
Owens. Oh, wait, excuse me, Miss Pell. In the azure of me anger, I just remembered there was a lady present.
Come on in, Mr. Gallagher, Mr. Gavin Walpoint. It's him as can put you in the way of having your wrongs righted. Come on in, then, and don't be so shy. Mr. Gavin is one of ourselves. Stands for government and the people. With the people and by the people, you'll find to be as welcome as the flowers in May. Good evening, Mr. Gaffer. And God and his holy angels be between you and all harm.
Come on, Mr. Gallagher, don't be a stranger. Sure, we're all friends here. I'm particular to be done. Any advice asked, here's your man here.
I'm very busy just now, Mrs. Henderson,
don't
to be honest.
Don't be put out, Mr. Davern. We won't keep you more than a few minutes. It's not in me or Mr. Gallagher to spoil sport. Him and me was young once, and knows what it is to be strolling at night in the pale moonlight with the arms around one another. And I wouldn't take much in Sadie's game in Mr. Gallagher still, for I've seen sometimes a dangerous cock in his eye. Eh? But listen, we won't keep you long or thunder. He's a letter now written. You must know, Mr. Dafferty. Excuse me for not introducing him sooner. This is Mr. Gallagher, who lives in the front drawing room of number 55. As decent and honest and quiet a man as you'll meet in a day's walk. And so signs on it, its stem will be imposed upon. Read the letter, Mr. Gallagher.
Read away, Mr. Gallagher. Never fear. It will be attended to. We know our own, eh, Mr. Davern?
Hurry up, Mr. Gallagher, and don't be keeping Mr. Davern. Give him to him, Minnie Powell. Give him to him. You must know, in all fairity, Mr. Davern, that the people in the next room to Mr. Gallagher, or the back drawing room, to be particular. Am I right or am I wrong, Mr. Gallagher?
You're right, Mrs. Henderson. Perfectly right.
That's the very identical room.
Well, Mr. Davern, the people in the back drawing room, or to be more particular, the residents. That's the word that was written in the letter. Am I right or am I wrong, Mr. Gallagher?
You're right, Mrs. Henderson, perfectly accurate. That's the very identical room.
Well, Mr. Davern, the residents, as aforesaid, is nothing but a gang of tramps. And oughtn't to be allowed to associate with decent, honest, quiet, respectable people. Mr. Gallagher has tried to reason with them and get them to behave themselves, which in my opinion they never will. However, that's just an opinion and it's not legal. And ever since they have made Mr. Gallagher's life a hell. Mr. Gallagher, am I right or am I wrong?
I'm sorry to say, Mrs. Henderson, you're right, perfectly right. Not a word of exaggeration.
Well, now, Mr. Gallagher, seeing as I have given Mr. Davern there a fair account of how you're situated, and of these tramps' cleverality, I'll ask you to read the letter. Which I'll say, not because you're there, or because you're a friend of mine, is as good a letter as was decomposed by a scholar. Now, go on, Mr. Gallagher, and don't forget that top saying there.
One moment now, Mr. Gallagher. Is it the 21st or the 22nd?
The 21st, sir.
Thanks. Proceed, Mr. Gallagher.
To all to whom these presents come, greetings. Gentlemen of the Irish Republican Army.
There's a beginning for you, Mr. Taffer.
Oh, there's a lot in that saying, mind.
It's
a hard one about the British Empire.
Go on.
I wish to call your attention to the persecution me and my family has to put up with in respect of and appertaining to the residents of the back drawing room of the house known as number 55 St. Teresa Street in the parish of St. Thomas and the borough and city of Dublin. This persecution started 18 months ago, or to be precise, on the 10th day of the 6th month, 1920.
Precise? That's the word I was trying to think of. What's the ground from underneath their feet, so to speak? Go on, Mr. Gallagher.
We, the complainants, residents on the ground floor, deeming it disrespectable.
Which it was?
Deeming it disrespectable to have an open hall door and to have the hall turned into a playground, made a solemn protest. And in consequence, we, the complainants aforesaid, has had no peace ever since. On to the persecution, as aforesaid specified, we had to take out a summons again, as there were no Republican courts then. But we didn't proceed again, as me and me wife, to wit, James and Winifred Gallagher, has a strong objection to foreign courts as such. We had peace for some time after that, but now things have gone from bad to worse. The name calling and the language is something abominable.
Excuse me, Mr. Gallagher, but I think that the word shocking should be put in there after abominable. For the language used by these tramps is two ways of being looked at. Tis abominable to the children, but tis shocking to your wife. Am I right or am I wrong, Mr. Davern?
No, shocking is a right
to Tommy! Let Mr. Davern speak. Whatever Mr. Davern says, Julia Henderson will avoid me.
I think the word might certainly be introduced with advantage.
Go over there and put in the word shocking, as aforesaid.
There's two K's in shocking.
The language is something abominable and shocking. My wife has often to lock the door of the room to keep them from assaulting. If you would be so kind as to send up some of your army or police to see for themselves, we will give them full particulars. I have to be always from home all day, as I work for Mr. Pat Hennessy, the harness maker of the Coombe, who will furnish full particulars as to my unvarnished reputation, also my neighbours. The name of the resident tenant who has given all this trouble, and who, pursuant to the facts of the case aforesaid mentioned, will be the defendant, is Dwyer. The husband of the aforesaid Mrs. Dwyer, or the aforesaid defendant, as the case may be, is a seaman who is coming home shortly. And we beg the Irish Republican Army to note that the said Mrs. Dwyer says he will settle us when he comes home, while leaving it entirely in the hands of the gentlemen of the Irish Republican Army, the defendant, that's to say James Gallagher of 55 St. Teresa Street, begs to venture to think that he's made out a primi facie case against the said Mrs. Dwyer and all her heirs, male and female, as aforesaid mentioned in the above written sketch. Notey Benny, if you send up any of your men, please tell them to take their guns. I beg to remain the humble servant and devoted admirer of the gentlemen of the Irish Republican Army. Witness my hand this 10th day of the 5th month, 1920. James Gallagher.
There's a man for you. There's a letter for you, Mr. Gallagher.
That is the finest letter I have ever heard read.
It wasn't you, Derry, really, Mr. Gallagher.
Sinn Féin, I won him and him only, Minnie. I seen him with my own two eyes when me and Winnie, Mrs. Gallagher, Mr. Daverton, aforesaid as appears in the letter, was sitting by the fire having a chat.
You'd never think it was in him to do it.
No.
And to think that the likes of such a man is to have the sole case worried out of him over a gang of tramps. Well, it's in good hands now, and instead of them settling news, Mr. Gallagher, it's you who'll be settling them. Give the letter to Mr. Daverton and we'll be going. Mr. Shears is getting on all right, Mr. Daverton.
Oh, very well, thanks, Mrs. Henderson. We don't see much of each other, really. He's out during the day and I'm usually out during the evening.
I'm afraid he'll never make a fortune out of what he's selling. He'll talk above an hour over a penny worth of pins. Every time he comes round our place, do you know, I do buy a packet off him just to give him a little encouragement. Clear to God, of as many hairpins as you'd make a wire mattress for a double bed. Odd young divas about the place is beginning to make a jeer of him too. I gave one of them a malavogan the other day for calling him old hairpins.
Mr. Shields is a man of exceptional mental capacity and is worthy of a more dignified position.
Them words is true, Mr. Gallagher, and theirs. For to be wise is to be a fool, and to be a fool is to be wise.
And Mrs. Henderson, that's a paradox.
It may be what a paradox, or a blackboard, or for the matter of that a lark, but it's what Julia Henderson thinks.
Stop press!
He wishes that a stop press! Run out of press. Talking about it till we see what it is.
We haven't got it,
mate. I've never seen any other way, and you'll always be the same if you keep following your spearmints and your bumblebees and your night patrols. Is that a stop press, Mrs. Freakson?
An ambush. Are they knocks it down?
Oh, that's the stuff to give them.
Was anybody hurted?
One poor man killed. Some chap named Maguire, the paper was saying.
What name did she say?
Maguire, do you know him, Mr. Davenport?
Yes, no. I didn't know him, Minnie. No, I didn't.
I wonder, is that the Maguire that could be in with Mr. Shears?
Ah, no, it couldn't have been.
Sedan, is that in the county of Sligo, if I'm not greatly mistaken?
That's where it is, Noxedan, the very identical county.
Well, we'd better be making a move. We've kept Mr. Davin long enough, and you'll find the letter to be in good hands.
Mr. Davin, sir, on behalf of myself, James Gallagher, and Winifred, Mrs. Gallagher, wife of the said James, I beg to offer, extend and furnish our humble and hearty thanks for your benevolent goodness in interfering in the matter specified, particularized and expanded upon in the letter, mandamus or schedule as the case may be. And let me interpret it to you, on behalf of myself and Winifred Gallagher, that whenever you visit, you will be supernally positive of 100,000.
There's a man for you, Mr. Dufferton. You forgot to mention Biddy and Sean. He's two children. Tis himself hasn't trained well. Oh, it would make your heart thrill like an alarm clock to hear them singing Faith of Our Fathers or Wrap the Green Flag Around Me.
Faith and Fatherland, Mrs. Henderson. Faith and Fatherland.
A good day to you, Mr. Dufferton. And God keep you and strengthen all the men that are fighting for Ireland's freedom.
Father, speak.
Father,
We better be off too soon, Mr. Davern. I remember. Tommy Owens only waits the call.
So long, Minnie.
Oh, you're found, eh, Gallop?
For yourselves once more, Minnie. Huh?
When that Tommy Owens give you to sick, only wait to hear the call. Take half the brass bands in the country to blow the call before Tommy Owens will hear it. Sacred Heart, I've only 10 minutes to get back to work. Quick, Mr. Owens. Write me name and typewriter before I go. Just Minnie. Now yours underneath. Just Dolan.
Your milk.
I haven't time to take you now. I'll come for it later this evening.
Minnie, kiss I didn't get.
What kiss?
Before, when we were interrupted earlier. You know you little rogue. Come on, just one.
Maybe later.
Minnie, Donald Minnie. Very pretty. Very ignorant. Gunman on the run.
Be careful. Be careful, Donald and Daverick.
But still, Minnie is attracted to the idea.
And I am attracted to Minnie. And what danger can there be in being the shadow of a gunman?
Transformed yet stays the same. Ah, shame.
You yourself were a lovely human orb, wandering through clouds of whirling human dust. She makes all beautiful on which she smiles. She couldn't make this thrice accursed room look beautiful. Her beams of beauty would only make its horrors more horrific still. There's an ugliness that can be made beautiful. And there's an ugliness that can only be destroyed. And this is part of that ugliness. Oh, Donald Davin, we fear your last state is worse than your first. As night ascended through the clouds, with slow and solemn tread, the queenly moon looked down on life below, as if she read man's soul, and in her scornful silence said, all happiest and beautiful things are dead.
Don't be you awake? Don't
be asleep? I'm neither awake nor asleep. I'm thinking.
I was just thinking too that McGuire's sorry now he didn't come with me instead of going to Knoxton Down. He caught something besides butterflies. Two of them he got, one through each lung.
The Irish people are very fond of turning a serious thing into a joke. That was a serious affair for poor McGuire.
Why didn't he do what he arranged to do? Did he think of me when he was going to Knoxton Down? I hardly have any sympathy for him now.
You can hardly expect that now that he's dead.
Well, publicans will do a lot for him now. How am I supposed to get back half the things he has belonging to me either? There's some of them in that bag over there, but that's not a quarter of what he had. I know where he was stopping for. He left his old digs a week or so ago. Suppose there's nothing to be said about my loss. I'm deserved done.
I hope there's nothing else in that bag besides threads and hairpins.
What else would be in it? I can't sleep properly ever since they put on this damn curfew. A minute ago I thought I heard some of the old ones standing at the door. They won't be satisfied that they bring a raid on the house. And they never begin to stand at the door till after curfew. You going to bed, don't you?
No, I'm trying to finish this poem.
Why was you who give that game up? Doesn't pay a working man to write poetry. I don't profess to know much about poetry. I don't know much about the pearly glint of the morning dew, or the damask sweetness of the rare wild rose, or the subtle greenness of the serpent's eye. But I think a poet's claim to greatness depends on his power to put passion in the common people.
Aye, passion. Aye. Passion to howl for his destruction. The people. Damn the people. They live in the abyss. The poet lives in the mountaintop. To the people there's no imagination of colour. It's simply the scarlet coat of a soldier, the purple vestment of a priest, the green banner of a party, the brown and blue overalls of industry. To them, the might of the Zion is a three-roomed house or a capacious bed. To them, beauty is for sale in a butcher shop. To the people, the end of life is the limb that is created for them. To the poet, the end of life is the life he creates for himself. Life has a stifling grip upon the people's throat. It is the poet's musician. The poet ever strives to save the people. The people ever strive to destroy the poet. The people view life through creeds, through customs, and through necessities. The poet views creeds, customs, and necessities through life. The poet...
Wish, is that the tapping again?
Tapping? What tapping?
This is the second night I heard that tapping. I believe they're both no good to me. There, do you hear it again? A quiet, steady, mysterious tapping on the wall.
I hear no tapping.
It'd be better for me if you did. It's a sure sign of death when nobody hears about myself.
Death? What the devil are you talking about, man?
There's always something like that I heard when one of our family dies.
I don't know about that, but there's a hell of a lot of things heard when one of your family lives.
God between us and all harm. Thanks be to God, I'm where it ought to be. In bed, it's always best to be in your proper place when such things happen. Say it now! There it is again! Do not hear it now!
How would you ever go asleep?
Do you believe in nothing?
I don't believe in tapping.
There, stop. Go to bed again for fear to begin again.
I do. And if it starts again, I'll be sure to waken you up.
It's a bit cold.
I thought you were gone asleep.
Bloody cold won't let me. I don't want a pair of pyjamas on you. Do you ever wear pyjamas, don't you?
No, no, no!
What kind of stuff is in them?
Oh, it depends on the climate. In India, silk. In Italy, satin. And the Eskimo wears them with the skin of the polar bear.
If I was you, I'd get into bed. That poem is beginning to get in your nerves.
Right, I'm off to bed now, so you can shut up.
I was going to say something there. Yes, it was. Oh, yeah. When I was coming in this evening, I saw Minnie Powell going out. If I was you, I wouldn't have the likes of her coming in here.
She comes in. I don't bring her in, do I?
The old ones will be talking, and once they start, you don't know how it'll end. Surely a man that has read Shelley couldn't be interested in an ignorant little bitch that thinks they're nothing but jazz dances, foxtrots, picture theatres, and dress.
Very glad I am that she thinks of dress. For she thinks of it in the right way and makes herself a pleasant picture to the eye. Education has been wasted on many persons who teaches them to talk only and leaves them with all their primitive instincts. If poor Minnie had had an education, she'd have been an artist. She's certainly a pretty girl. I'm sure she's a good girl. And I believe she's a brave girl.
A Helen of Troy come to live in a tenement. You think a lot about her simply because she thinks a lot about you. And she thinks a lot about you only because she sees you as a hero or a kind of Paris. She gives the world an odd to be gadding about with a gunman. And what ecstasy if you'd give her if after a bit you were shot or hanged. Oh, she'd be able to go out then. Like a good Manny Moore singing, I do not mourn me darling lost for he fell in his jacket green. Dead for a year and a day. All around her hat she'd wear the tri-coloured ribbon all. Till she'd pick up and marry someone else. Possibly a British Tommy with a mod star. And as for being brave, tis easy to be that when you've no cause for coward. I wouldn't fancy having me live depending on brave little Minnie Powell. She wouldn't sacrifice a jazz dance to save it.
There, that's enough about Minnie Powell. I'm afraid I'll have to be on the run out of this house too. It's becoming painfully obvious that there's no peace to be found here.
This house is all right. Barring the children, it does be quite enough. Weren't there children in the last place you were in as well, though?
Aye, 10. And they were all over 40.
It's pretty quiet now, isn't it? I don't know how any man who shot anybody can go about sleeping in peace at night.
Plenty of men can't sleep in peace at night now unless they know that they have shot somebody.
I wish to God it was all over. Instead of counting their beads, now they're counting bullets. Their Hail Marys and Paternosters are bursting bombs. Bursting bombs and the rattle of machine guns. The petrol is their holy water. Their De Profundis is the soldier song, and their creed is, I believe in the good Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. And it's all for the glory of God and the honour of Ireland.
Well, you remember the time you yourself believed in nothing but the gun.
When there wasn't a gun in the country. I've a different opinion now when there's nothing but guns in the country. And you dare to open your mouth. For Kathleen Houlihan is very different now to the woman who used to play the harp and sing, weep on, your hour is past. But she's a raging devil now. If you only look crooked at her, you're sure of a punch of die. But this is the way I look at it. I look at it this way. You're not going to beat the British Empire. The British Empire! By shooting an occasional Tommy on the corner of an occasional street. Besides, when the Tommies have the window, they let bang at everything they see. They don't give a God's course who they plug.
Maybe they ought to jump down off the lorry
run to the records office and find out a man's pedigree before they plug him.
It's the civilians that suffer. And there's an ambush, they don't know where to run. Shot in the back to save the British Empire, and shot in the breast to save the soul of Ireland. I'm an nationalist myself, right enough. I'm a nationalist, right enough, but all the same, I am a nationalist, right enough. I believe in the freedom of Ireland, and that England has no right to be here. But I draw the line when I hear the gunmen blowing about dying for the people, when it's the people that are dying for the gunmen. With all due respect to the gunmen, I don't want them to die for me.
Not likely. You object to any one of them deliberately dying for you for fear that one of these days you might accidentally die for one of them.
Oh, you're one of the brave fellows who doesn't fear death, huh?
Why should I fear it? It's all the same to me, where it happens, when it happens, or how it happens. I leave fear of death to those who are always praying for eternal life. Death is here, death is there, death is busy everywhere.
In Ireland, thanks be to God, I'm a daily communicant. There's a great comfort in religion. No man need be afraid when a crowd of angels round him. Thanks be to God for his holy religion.
Yeah, you're welcome to your angels. Philosophy is mine. Philosophy that makes the coward brave, the sufferer defiant, the weak strong.
This is Mary Joseph, wasn't it?
It's very close.
No Christianity at all.
Are we ever going to know peace and security again?
If this continues much longer, I'll be known by gallivanting Paddyman shops.
Oh, it's dangerous to be in, and it's equally dangerous to be out.
See, it's a dangerous place to be in with them windows. You never know the minute a bullet will come in through one of them and hit the wall.
Why can't you say so without making a song about it?
I don't think that there's horses in the stables at all.
Stables? What stables are you talking about?
Stable at the back of the house with the entrance of the yard. It's used as a carpenter shop. Did you never hear the peculiar noises at night? They say that it's the horses shaking their chains.
And what is it?
Oh, there, I leave you.
Oh, surely you don't mean.
I do.
You do mean what?
I wouldn't be surprised.
Yes, surprised. Go on.
I wouldn't be surprised if they were manufacturing bombs there.
My God. That's a pleasant contemplation. The sooner I'm on the run out of this house, the better. How is it you never told me any of this before?
I didn't want to frighten you.
Look, you're bloody quiet.
You asleep, Mr. Shields?
Oh, my God, what do you want now? No, Mrs. Gregson.
Oh, he hasn't turned up yet. I'm stiff with the cold waiting for him.
Mr. Gregson, is it?
I don't know, yeah. He will have for his tea at 6 o'clock. No, I tell a lie. It was before 6, because I remember the Angelus ringing out, and we were sitting at the table after taking his tea at 6 o'clock. He went out for a breath of fresh air. I haven't seen sight in the mind of him since. Honest to God, my heart's in my mouth thinking he's been shot by the Patent Arms.
You'll be all right, Mrs. Gregson. Go to bed and rest yourself. It's always the worst that comes into our body's mind. Go to bed, Mrs. Gregson, or you'll catch your death of cold.
I'm too afraid to go to bed, Mr. Shields, because I'm always in dread that some night or another, after he's taken a sup, he'll fall down them kitchen stairs and he'll break his neck. I mean, not that I'd be any the worse off if anything did happen to him. I mean, you know the sort he is, Mr. Shields. He's got me half brown.
You never know, though, Mrs. Gregson. Don't be downhearted. Maybe one of these days he'd turn over a new leaf.
Sorry for Dulcet Griggs will have turned over. He's too far gone in the arms for that. Doesn't matter how much he's drank. Whenever he takes some more, he'll always say, "Here's the first today."
Christ, is she going to stop talking there all the night?
Shh, she'll hear you. Right enough, the man has the poor woman's heart broke.
And because he has her heart broken, she has to have the privilege of breaking everybody else's.
Mr. Shields?
Yes, Mrs. Griggs.
Do them insurance companies pay out if a man shot up to curfew?
Oh, now, that's something I couldn't say, Mrs. Griggs.
Isn't he a terrible man, eh? Taking such risks, not knowing what's going to happen to him. after what now, Mr. Shields?
It must be after one, Mrs. Gregson.
Then if I was a young woman again, I'd think twice before getting married. There's somebody there. It's him. I can tell by the way he's fumbling. Is that you, Toby, dear? Oh, Toby, dear, mind yourself.
I'm all right. Do you see anything wrong with me?
Of course you're all right, Toby, dear. There's no one minding you.
Minding me, is it? Minding me? It wouldn't be a good thing with mind me. There's a man here, afraid of nothing. Not in this bloody house, anyway.
Come on downstairs, Dorothy, dear. There's no one here to say a word to you.
Say a word to me, is it? Say a word to me? It wouldn't be a good thing but say anything to Dolphus Gregson. Does anyone in the house want to say anything to Dolphus Gregson? If there is, he's here, a man. There's no blotting it out, a man.
Just speak quiet, Dolphy. You're going to wake everyone up.
What do I care for anyone in the house? Are they keeping me? Are they giving me anything? When they're keeping Gregson, it'll be time enough for them to talk. I can tell them Adolphus Gregson wasn't born in a bottle.
Why'd you talk like that, Dolphy, dear? We all know
there's some in this house think Gregson was born in a bottle.
A most appropriate place for him to be born in.
Come on downstairs now, Dolphy, dear, to bed. And we can talk about them in the
morning. I'll talk about them now. Do you think I'm afraid of them? Adolphus Gregson's afraid of nothing. Creeping or walking. If anyone in the house thinks he's fit to take a fall out of Adolphus Gregson, he's here. A man. There's no blotting it out.
Oh,
a man.
Dear lass, pain forever and ever.
Dolphy, dear, poor Mr. Davern wants to go to bed.
Oh, she's terribly anxious about poor Mr. Davern all of a sudden.
Davern. He's a man. We'll leave it there, mate. You needn't be afraid of Adolphus Gregson. There was never a drop of him farmer's blood in the whole family of Gregson. I don't know what you are. I don't know what you think. But you're a man. Not like some of the gougers in this house that would hang you. Not referring to you, Mr. Sheen.
You don't talk to Mr. Sheen.
I know that now, Mr. Gregson. Go on down now with Mrs. Gregson and have a sleep for yourself. All right.
I tie myself to no woman's apron strings, Mr. Shields. I know how to keep Mrs. Gregson in her place. I have the authority of the Bible for that. I know the Bible from cover to cover, Mr. Davern, which is more than some in this house can say. And what does the Holy Scripture say about a woman? It says a woman shall be the subject of her husband. And I'll see to it that Mrs. Gregson keeps to the teaching of the Holy Book in the letter and the spirit. And Mr. Davern, if ever you're in trouble and Gregson can help, I'm your man. Have you, mate?
I have you, Mr. Gregson. I have you.
Right. I'm an orange man. I'm not ashamed of it, and I'm not afraid of it. But I can feel for a true man all the same. Have you got me, Mr. Shields?
We know you well, Mr. Gregson. Many a true Irish man was a Protestant. Tone, Emmett, Parnell.
Mind you, I'm not saying as I agree with some of you mentioned, for the Bible forbids it, and Adolphus Gregson will always abide by the Bible. Fear God, honour the King. It's written in the Holy Scriptures, and there's no blotting it out. But here, Mr. Davern, have a drink. Just to show there's no coolness.
No, Mr. Gregson. It's too late now to take anything. Go on down with Mrs. Gregson and we'll have a chat in the morning.
You sure you won't have a drink?
Quite sure, all the same, thanks.
Well, here's the first today to all true men, even if they were born in a bottle. To King William, to the Battle of the Boyne, to the Hope of Black Chapter, that's my lords, Mr. Davern, and to the Orange Lily. And did you go to see the show, East Rose and Piccadilly, oh, and feast your eyes upon the prize won by the Orange Lily? The Viscount, they're so debonair, dressed like a daffodilio, and Lady Clark, why that's a lark, approach the Orange Lilio. Hey-ho, the Lilio, the loyal Orange Lilio, cat, a flower can buy with their hands orange lily.
Holy God, isn't this terrible?
The elated used to hear the news jump like a corner filly, and gossip in the low proclaim the triumph of the
just to make sure of everything now. Have a look at that bag of McGuire's. Not that there can be anything in it.
If there's nothing in it, what's the point of looking?
It won't kill you to look, will it? You're joking.
Wait till the times come, you'll find whether I'm joking or no.
Isn't this a nice figure to be in? St. Anthony looked down on us.
Why would you stop blaming St. Anthony? What did you let McGuire leave the bag there for?
What did I let him leave the bag here for? What did I let him? Didn't I think there was not my spoons and hairpins, huh? What are we doing now? There'll be no rate to do it. I knew things would go wrong when I missed Mass this morning.
Don't you ever give over your praying and let us think about what's best to be done. There's one thing for certain. As soon as morn comes, I'm on the run out of this house.
Even me to bear the brunt of it, just like the rest of you.
And why shouldn't you bear the brunt of it? McGuire was no friends of mine. And besides, it is your fault. You knew the sort of man he was, and you should have been on your guard.
Did I know he was a gunman?
Bombs! In the park there!
I'll never miss mass again. If it's the Tommies, it won't be so bad. But if it's the Tans, we're going to have a terrible time.
Who's there?
Who's there?
Who's there?
Only myself and my mate Dutter Baird.
Why didn't you open the door?
I didn't hear you knocking.
Oh, so. You must be in a lot of hearing, eh?
I had rheumatic fever a few years ago, and ever since I do be a little deaf sometimes.
How is it you're not in bed?
It wasn't bad, but someone heard the knocking. I got up to answer the door.
Oh, you're a nice bloke, you are. Delighted, like. Have a visit from us, eh? Aye? Why don't you answer?
Yes, sir.
What's your name?
Davern. Davern, sir.
An Irishman, are you?
I was born in Ireland.
Well, Irish and proud of it, eh? What's your name?
Jimmy Shields, sir.
Oh, you're a Celt, eh? One of those Celtic race that speaks a link of its own, eh? That's going to overthrow the British Empire? I don't think. Where's it going?
I never had a gun in my hand in my life, sir.
Oh, no, you wouldn't know what gun is if you saw one, I suppose. What's that?
Please be careful.
Why would you be careful about
that? I mean, the gun, eh? It might go off.
Price if it did. It can always be reloaded. Any ammunition here? What's in that crate?
Only a little bit of you get nothing here, son. No one in their house has any connection with politics.
Now, I never met a man yet that didn't say that, but we're a little bit too high, you know, to be kidding with that sort of talk.
I'll get a drink of water.
You want a barrel of war before you're done with us? What's here? A statue of Christ? And a crucifix? You think he was in a blooming monastery, eh?
The bed is nice and flat down. Upstairs and downstairs, the maid can lift everything. And the fan of my father with me on the dolphin's pillow, and the drink and every drop of it. Oh God, he'll be like a devil in the morning when he finds he's got
the whiskey, eh? Hey, where are you leaving? Where are you leaving?
When you go down, tell them not to drink! Look, the gunmen are listening to me.
I'm searching the whole house, Mrs. Grayson. Oh,
there isn't a thing in the kitchen. The thing I'm flitting around the floor. All the things I keep in the cupboard and all the odds and ends in the big boxes.
And they're a terrible gang of blackguards. They hardly go upstairs. You think they would up to meet me pal's room?
I did just show them the sort of man he was. Before they came in, Duffy, he put the big Bible on the table. And he opened it at the first Gospel of St. Peter, second chapter. And he marked verses 13 to 17 in red ink. You know the passages, Mr. Shields? Submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be unto the king as supreme, or unto governors, for unto them are sent by him, for the punishment of evildoers, and the praise of them that do well. The Brotherhood, fear God, honour the King. Do you know what they did there, Mr. Shields? They took the Bible and they flung it on the floor. I mean, imagine that, flinging the Bible on the floor. And then one of them says to the other, Jack, he says, is your soul saved? Have you seen the light? And then they grabbed hold of poor Dolphy and they were calling him Mr. Moody. And Mr. Sankey, and they were wanting him to offer up a prayer for the Irish public. And then, just as they were putting me out, they got up a poor man and they sat him up in bed with his arms across his breast and his eyes were looking up at the ceiling and he was singing at him, we shall meet by the sweet by and by. And all the time, Mr. Shields, he was drinking his whiskey.
The name of all that sensible. Why do they have to bring whiskey home with them for? They're bad enough sober. What are they going to be like when they're drunk?
He always brings the job home. He calls it his medicine.
Did hardly search all the house. You think they will, Mrs. Gibson?
We have this picture over the mantelpiece of King William crossing the boy. And do you know they're trying to make out, Mr. Shields? The name was Robert Evers. And some picture of some sacred society.
The people's hopeless.
Tell her to get the hell out of here. She's worse than the oxy.
No. Let her stay where she is. It's safer to have her. I hope to God if they find the bombs, Minnie will say nothing.
We're a pair of dastardly cowards. To let Minnie suffer when we know that we and not she are to blame.
What else do you want us to do? What do you want us to be done in? If you're anxious to get rid of them, I'm not. Besides, they won't harm her. She's only a girl. She keeps her mouth shut, Jimmy Arling.
I wish I could be sure of that.
What are you doing now, Mrs. Grigson?
Stop it, I mean, that's unshakable, Jimmy.
I'd have gone upstairs, Mrs. Grigson. Do you think, Mrs. Grigson?
Oh, I see him. Poor Dorothy's sitting up in the bed. I swear to God, I can't think of hearing all the guns going off. And then I see him stretched out dead in the bed. Oh, God bless us. I think I hear him moaning.
I just want to be talking to a stone. Homeless, the baby's homeless. She thinks she hears him moaning. It's bloody near time somebody made a moan.
Oh, he's moaning the loss of his whiskey.
Come on, you get the
cover
now!
Might go off and throw someone. Have you, mate?
What am I
it does, is it? Sir, a man can only die once. You'll find bricks and won't sway. God, you're a cool one, says the other. And there's no planning it out.
That's the best way to take it.
Yeah.
It only makes things worse to show them you got the wind up. Any ammunition here? The fellow comes in here. I don't think so, says I, but you better have a look. No back talk, says he, or you might get plumped. I don't know of any clause, says I, in the British Constitution that makes it a crime for a man to speak in his own room. With that, we just had a look around and off they went.
If a man keeps the stuff looking in front,
I thought it shall soon deprive the view of that fine city. Then I took a stroll all among the quality. Me bundle, it was stolen in an elite locality. Some that passed me mine, when I looked behind, a bundle could I find upon me? Stick the bottle and